Hello, ladies and gentlemen. My name is Phil Mayo. I'd like to invite you to your ringside seat at the Kyokushinkai World Rated Championships, which are here held in Holland. Kyokushinkai, if you don't know, is an international form of karate which was invented by the great Masayama of Japan. It's now practiced and fought throughout the world. Basically, I'll run through the rules as we go on in the competition with you. As you can see here, the fight is taking part on a matted area of around about 25 feet square. Each competitor is allowed to strike to almost all the areas of the body except to the face with the fists, but they are allowed to strike to the face and head with the legs. Consequently, as you see, the majority of the punching will be directed towards the midsection. The aim is to basically score on points, or ultimately by a knockdown, or even knockout if possible. In this case, you're allowed to do that, as I say, with a kick to the head, but not with a punch to the head. They can also strike to the opponent's legs with kicks or punches, although mostly that would be done with kicks, in the attempt to give the opponent what we call a dead leg, which would drop him, and unless he'd managed to recover within a short period, would put him right out of the competition. Opponent there on the left-hand side of the screen throwing two rather high and powerful roundhouse kicks to the head of his opponent, but not quite managing to make full contact there. Two good attempts though, nevertheless. The rules of this competition have changed over the years, as is to be expected in most fighting competition. At one time, you were allowed to grip behind the neck of your opponent and draw them down onto the knee, to use the knee into the face, but that has been outlawed now. A powerful low kick there too, from the guy with the red tape on the back of his belt. You'll notice that unlike most normal karate competition, these Kyokushinkai fighters are not allowed to wear hand padding of any sort. Just a little taping there is allowed on to stop them from splitting their knuckles. That's the end of that round. You'll see around the matted area, you'll see there are three judges there holding those white flags. They're the guys who will decide as to whether or not, or who is the winner. The referee calling there for the judges, and the judges are crossing their flags there, which means a draw, so the referee turns and indicates that there will be a continuation of two more minute rounds to try to get a winner out of these two. As I was saying, in this particular form of karate competition, they're not allowed to use any padding either to the fists or very much to the legs either. So consequently, it's a very, very bruising form of competition. A guy punching there to the face, now that is an illegal punch. Fortunately, it wasn't particularly hard for him, so it didn't result in any damage. The referee breaking them up there as one fighter was clinching onto the other one. And that was a nice takedown. Neither of these guys are able to make very much impression on it either. They're both obviously in similarly fit condition. The referee just issuing a warning to this man. I don't know what that was for. Attempting that spinning crescent kick there, but not really much of an effective kick unless it's actually thrown to the head. Oh, good inside roundhouse kick was thrown there and caught his opponent right to the jaw, now followed by a takedown. Well, now it's down to the judges to decide. You see this roundhouse kick coming down off the left leg and straight into his opponent's face. Not very effective. He didn't get it quite in distance enough in order to knock him down with it, but nevertheless a good looking kick anyway. And here we go again with another one, but that being blocked down by his opponent. So now it's down to the judges to decide on the winner. We have two white flags raised. I think the other guy had it as a draw, but that means that it goes over to the guy on the right wins. We'll move on to the next two opponents. It seems to have sustained a punch in the mouth there in that clash. I didn't actually see anything hit him there, but undoubtedly something did, but it doesn't look as if there's been anything particularly, any real damage. The referee is giving there a warning. He's not actually taken a point away there, he's just given a warning for head contact. There's a good front kick there, almost strikes his opponent in the mouth. Throwing in some good low kicks there, but not with particularly very much power in actual fact. And in order to be effective with a kick to the leg, you really have got to turn in and put some power into it. In the dark belt turning his back on his opponent there, which is a very, very dangerous thing to do, especially without keeping his guard up. He could have hardly just sustained a really good, powerful roundhouse kick to the head. Well, that's what Kyokushinkai knockdown is about. When you get a good technique like that, up it comes and strikes him straight behind the ear. That would score very heavily. That is a very good knockdown. Excellent knockdown. It was quite clear there he was only momentarily stunned. He's got a smile on his face, so he's certainly not injured to any extent. So presumably they will allow the competition to go on. It depends entirely on the referee and judges now. Yes, they're allowing it to continue on, awarding a full point there for that score. Well, that was a spirited attack with the guy with the dark belt coming straight in there. Hoping to score with his own head kick knockdown, but not quite managing it. Throwing again another roundhouse kick. The referee there is warning him about holding and hitting at the same time. They're not allowed to actually grab hold of the opponent's leg and strike at the same time. That was a good roundhouse kick thrown there, but just ducking underneath it. The guy in the dark belt now has got everything to do, so he's throwing caution to the wind and just coming straight in attacking. Has to be careful here because he could get caught. He could get caught by a powerful knockdown blow as he comes in. Now it looks like a kick caught him in the groin there. That is basically an occupational hazard in any form of fighting where one's using kicks. This is nearly always you'll find that some stage or another somebody will get kicked to the groin. Most competitors do wear protective boxes. Another good roundhouse kick coming up to the head, but not quite connecting. He's quite effective with his kicks, this guy in the yellow belt, but he's just managing to get it so that he contacts. Well, that's the end of that round, so I think it's undoubtedly going to go to the yellow belt. But we're just seeing this roundhouse kick coming round again. Look at that. Straight to the side of the face. Didn't actually follow through enough there to get the knockdown, though. And all of the judges there scoring it in favour of the yellow belt. Yeah, that's a very fair decision. We'll start with the next competition. I'm sorry, unfortunately, I'm not able to give you the names of these competitors. We weren't supplied with the names of them when we were supplied with the tape. I hope that won't spoil your appreciation of the event too much. Attempted spinning kick there, a wheel kick. The idea is to spin and strike your opponent with the heel. Unfortunately for him, he didn't quite manage to get it round or high enough, in fact, to do any damage. There's a hard punch there, has hit the guy in the jaw. Doesn't look like any particular damage has been done, but the perpetrator will certainly get a warning if not lose points for this. Good roundhouse kick coming round, yes. Don't think that the referee will score that as a knockdown, though. The roundhouse kick was there, but it wasn't actually powerful enough. It didn't actually make any strong contact. The referee is just consulting with the judges to decide as to whether or not to score that as an actual knockdown. Yes, in actual fact, he is scoring a point. He is giving a point for that. Good spinning kick there. This is a particularly aggressive battle. Now that kick that you saw there is what they call a rolling C kick. I don't know what they would call it in the Japanese name, but that is one which is quite common amongst Kyokushinkai fighters. If it's done properly, I have seen people literally pole-axed with it. The idea is to spin right over and strike downwards with the heel to the head of the opponent. And if it's done properly, as I say, it's a very, very effective kick. Having said that, it's also an extremely difficult kick to do. Trying that again. It involves a kind of a somersaulting towards your opponent, so you really do have to be quite athletic to be able to successfully execute such a kick. good roundhouse kick there, you know, as he's just hooking behind the head and pulling that kick right up into the face. Fortunately for his opponent, he rolled his head back just at the last second and managed to take away the force of it, so he wasn't actually knocked down. He's trying it again there, similar technique. Well, so that's the end of that competition. It's over to the judges now. That was a particularly good competition. That was quite an exciting and aggressive match. Okay, and we have a majority decision there in favour of the guy on the left. So that was a good decision. I think that was quite fair. Okay, we've got a considerable difference in the height of these two guys now. The guy wearing the yellow belt being considerably taller than the guy in the black belt. Oh, it didn't seem to make much point, much difference there. The shorter guy put in a beautiful jumping spinning kick there, just slightly out of distance there. Didn't quite manage to make full contact. I think he would have taken his opponent's head off his shoulders if he had. Probably just as well that he wasn't then, for that matter. Don't be misled by the fact that you've got one guy wearing a yellow belt and another guy wearing a black belt there, which is a particularly a very large difference in the grade, the yellow belt being virtually at the other end of the grading system from black belt. They wear these belts anyway more for distinguishing for the judges' purposes, as well as the little red ribbon that you see tied behind the yellow belt. I've no doubt that both guys are in fact of a similar grade, probably both holding at least black belt grade. Now he's thrown in some good body shots there to the taller guy. The short man may not have the height, but he's certainly making it up in power. And his kicking ability is quite something to behold as well. Another wheel kick again, jumping wheel kick, but just not quite getting height and distance enough. Again, he's trying that one. If he was fighting against a guy of his own height, he would have probably knocked him out by now, but as I say, if he wants to make that work, he really needs to come in from a little more distance and jump a little bit higher, and then we might see some connection. That's a good knee technique there, doing that nice throwing in of the knee. You used to see a lot more of the use of the knee in these Kyokushinkai knockdown competitions until they banned the fighters from using the from gripping at the same time, and of course that made the use of the knee far less effective, so you don't see the happenings quite so much. Very powerful punches to the body that are being thrown there. That's a reverse punch, or in the Japanese gyakuzuki. Again, he's trying that wheel kick. Now, that will be determined as a foul technique, most definitely. It's probably a bit of tension and excitement of the competition has caused him to throw a kick to his opponent's head while he was on the floor. And then again, we have a majority decision there in favour of the short guy, which is a very fair decision. He certainly scored far more. Certainly look like two much larger and heavier fighters, much nearer the same height as well, so we should provide some interesting competition. Good low kick takedown there. Just looking at these big guys, it's interesting to note the fact that the film star Dolph Lundgren made his mark as a Kyokushinkai knockdown champion some years ago. I remember seeing him fight very successfully at the Crystal Palace in London. You could imagine a guy that size, there's just very few people who could actually stand up to him. Fighters are divided into weight categories, and fight a process of elimination. That was a good blow into the body there. I think it was a puncher, but I'm not too sure about that. I think the referee may judge that as being a low blow. We'll have to wait and see. The action can be so fast sometimes, it's rather difficult if you're not on the right side to be able to see exactly what happened. I didn't see them taking any points away from anybody, so presumably it was deemed as a perfectly legal blow. As they were saying, they fight in separate weight categories. Also, at the end of each round of eliminations, generally in these Kyokushinkai knockdown competitions, there is a period of breaking wood to demonstrate power. And I believe we'll also see some other very interesting demonstrations later on, which will include the breaking of baseball bats with the shin, no less, which if you've never seen it before, that is something which is well worth staying tuned for, believe me. Okay, and that's the end of that round. Well, that was a fairly closely fought battle. So it'll be interesting to see. We're just having this action replay here now of one of the strikes. Good reverse punch there into the chest. All the judges made their decision, and it goes over to the opponent on the right. We're down into the lighter weight categories now, so we should see more speedy technique in this particular competition. Good strikes going into the leg there. As I said, if you hit hard with a good low kick, catching your opponent into the thigh, it can give the effect of a dead leg, which is completely debilitating. Under those circumstances, your only option is really to go down to the ground, otherwise you're just going to take a lot more punishment because it just really does put you out of it. That was an attempted axe kick there that he threw up with his left leg. Rising up in the strike comes down with the heel. Again, he's doing that and he's striking down, but not quite managing to get to enough power to have effect there then. A nice roundhouse kick off the left leg, but not making any heavy contact. That was a spinning crescent kick there. Again, he's coming in with that axe kick. Again, a spinning kick there, that time spinning and attempting to strike with the heel. That is a very, very powerful technique. If you can actually catch your opponent with that, then you've got a very good chance of making a clean knockout. attempting a combination there of a hook kick on the left leg, followed through by a roundhouse kick on the right leg. Both of them being out of distance, though, not kind of managing to make contact. Both of these fighters really need to increase their forward drive on their techniques. I think the referee there is actually telling them that they're just simply not making enough contact, not making enough power into it. And I think the crowd is none too pleased about this competition either, as well, with the slow hang clap. This would be quite satisfactory in a semi-contact competition, but this is supposed to be full contact, so it's just not not meeting the mark. That's the end of that round of the competition. I, personally speaking, I didn't see anything between the two. I'd probably give it a draw, but I had to wait and see what the judge's decision is. But I think we have one draw and one to the white, so the judge is giving it over to the guy on the left. Just coming in there with that hook kick and then now following through with the roundhouse kick to the head. These were very nice techniques, but they just simply weren't actually making contact. And of course, contact is what it's all about. Lost balance there, we'll have to throw in that low kick. Oh, now that was a nice technique. It didn't quite manage to catch. You see, this is a spinning heel kick coming right round over the top of the opponent's shoulder, but it was actually in a little bit too close to be able to make contact with the heel. Throwing a low kick there in an attempt to take both of his opponent's legs out, but not quite managing to get in there. That's a jumping back kick. Both fighters exchanging some good techniques there, good blows to the body, followed by nice spinning kicks. As a blow there has hit the guy in the face, so it's interesting the comparison here. Whilst it's a foul blow to be hit hard in the face in any karate competition, these guys don't give any Oscar-winning performances that we often see in the non and semi-contact karate arena. It's just, okay, you hit me, so I'm back on my feet and carry on kind of thing. That's, for my part, is the way the karate competition should always be. Knee to the body went in there. When you watch this sort of competition, that you realise just how much punishment the human body can actually take without showing any real ill effects. You know, I mean, these guys are really throwing in some very hard techniques, the type of which if they were hitting somebody just in the sort, that was a technique that knee just went into his head. It'd be interesting to see as to what the decision comes of that, because he was ducking his head at the same time. So coming up first with that front kick to the body, And we see here his head, he ducks his head down, I think, more onto this. And that was, and there goes in with the knee. That was, it seems to be more of a, his forearm hit him as he ducked down. I don't think it was his deliberate forearm. Nevertheless, the referee there is giving him a warning. He's giving him a warning actually for pulling him onto the knee. Well, I'm not so sure that that is really fair, because I think the guy ducked more onto it, but that's the way it goes sometimes. Yeah, action heating up something here. Oh, good roundhouse kick. Just skipping over the top of his head. We're getting a little bit of athletics from the referee there then. Coming in with this flurry, and up comes that roundhouse kick, hit him. See, he ducked his head to the right, so he just scraped over the top, but nonetheless it actually caused him to go down momentarily, so the referee will award for that. Because of the break there, I wasn't too sure. I can't be too sure about exactly what's going on. I think that the referee was calling for an extra 1 or 2 minutes on this fight to get the decision out. Action slowed down quite considerably now. I think they've both probably taken a little bit of a breather after that flurry just a couple of minutes ago. Switch there, good switch from throwing to the lower body and then bringing up a roundhouse to the head, but it didn't quite make contact. Oh, nice takedown. Just sweeping to the inside of the ankle. Following up again there with that jumping heel kick. I think both of these guys are looking rather tired now, so there's a lot of power has gone out of their technique. And that's the end of the round. So it's over to the judges for them to make the decision now. We've got a split decision there. I think that they're going to go for an extra fighting period. I'm not too sure, we'll have to wait and see. No, the decision has gone over to the guy on the left. I think what happened there was you had the judges making an equal number for each side, so they went to the arbiter that we see sitting at the front of the screen here for him to give a final decision, and he's obviously come down in favour of the guy on the left. The referee has to keep calling the fighters to the centre of the fighting area every time they step out over and beyond that red area that you see at the back of the screen, which runs right around the fighting area. If an opponent continuously steps out from there, then he will get warned and eventually disqualified. Referee just stopping to adjust the guy's dress there. It looks like his belt was coming undone. And a nice spinning kick there, but being out of distance, so it doesn't score anything. The guy in the black belt seems to be the stronger of the two fighters, particularly with his punching. Good attempt at a roundhouse kick there from the yellow belt. Leg roundhouse kick on to his opponent's leg, and again, that can really slow a man up, and continuously kick in at one leg, get several kicks in, and very soon the guy can't walk around. Well, that's the end of the competition anyway, so it's not going to finish as a knockdown, so it goes over to the judges. Looks like the judges are scoring a draw, so we're going to end up having to have another couple of minutes of competition. The guy in the yellow belt is continuing this assault on his opponent's legs in the hope that he can weaken them down. That wasn't any knockdown there, the guy, he just spun around with that kick and lost his balance. Oh, nice low kick. That was a nice low kick, taking his opponent right off his feet. Still striking with the low kicks to that, his opponent's right leg. And so if he doesn't block those, then he's going to be limping about, something really shocking later on. Again, that low kick goes in. And this time, that was a good switch now there. He changed from the low kick up to the head. It didn't quite make contact, but if he'd have managed to twist it in harder, it would have really had a very good effect. But nevertheless, he's dropped his opponent, so that will be effective on the judges' scorecards. Unless there's a radical turnaround in the flow of things now, I think the guy in the yellow belt is definitely going to win this competition. It's over to the judges, so just wait and see what must have this time. Yeah. All judges in favour of yellow. That's a very fair decision. He did, certainly turned it on when it was necessary. That was a nice looking roundhouse kick to the head, unfortunately just not any real effective power in it. You've got to get just the right combination of technique and power in order to score a knockdown. Unfortunately, the majority of kicks that are thrown to the head just don't quite have it. Referee seems to be getting very much involved in this fight. I think it's a very good idea to see the guys, you know, if you notice that they're carrying their hands open quite a lot. That was quite a good looking spinning kick, but again, just not quite in distance in order to get the power into it. And they're saying that, you know, they're fighting with their hands open quite a lot. That's got to be a bad idea, because if you take a kick against those open hands, you can very easily get your fingers broken. I always recommend to keep your fists closed when you're doing this sort of thing. Just not a good idea at all to keep your hands open. And a nice spinning crescent kick there. Unfortunately, the camera was not quite at the right angle to get that properly. But if it had got it up a little bit higher, he could have connected it with the jaw. We would have had a knockout there. That's the end of that competition. And to be quite frank, I think it's anybody's guess as to which one of them has won that. Oh, there you go, the judges are coming down as a draw, so we're going to go on for another 2 minutes. As I said, I didn't think there was very much in it, to be honest with you. Carrying a fair bit of excess weight, the guy on the left. Certainly isn't a help to you when the going starts getting tough like this. Well, that was a very tired attempt at a spinning kick there. Never ceases to amaze me that fighters, when they get really tired, yet still sometimes to attempt to throw kicks like that. He's caught him with a kick to the groin there, so we'll have to wait and see as to whether or not his opponent is able to continue on, because it was quite a hard kick actually that went in there. He could get outright disqualification. Certainly he'll have points deducted, which will probably determine the outcome of this particular fight. Well, he appears to have recovered okay, so maybe we'll just be looking at a foul point deduction. Now, I've got an idea we're going to get a decision here, because, you know, we're seeing one of the judges put the whistle into his mouth and get hold of the flags ready, so... referee just ordering the fighter to adjust. No, the competition is going to continue on, so obviously they are going to just simply take points away from him for that contact with the groin. That was an attempt to throw a spinning kick to the face of his opponent there, but just about a foot out of distance. Both of these guys now are just basically leaning in on each other, close in with the punches and the knees. So that's the end of that competition. I think now that it will definitely go to the guy on the left, particularly with the points deduction that would have resulted as a result of that foul. I think we have another draw. Well, that's surprising. It surprises me anyway. Now what they're doing now is it goes to the weight. They will weigh each of these guys and the heavier guy will lose. And it's pretty obvious who is the heavier guy, so it's the guy on the left who wins, which for my part I think is a fair decision anyway. But that is a rule in this particular form of competition. If after the end of a couple of rounds they haven't reached a decision, then what they do is they weigh both of the fighters and the heavier of the two losers. So it certainly pays to make sure that you come in just inside the weight category, just inside the top of the weight category. That weight rule may be considered to be a bit of a tough thing when you think about the fact that just a 2 pound or 1 kilo weight difference can decide the outcome of a fight, when in reality it doesn't make very much difference to the actual effectiveness of your opponents. I wouldn't consider that a man who only has 1 kilo weight advantage over me to have any particular amount of extra strength or anything. You might have just had a bigger dinner or something like that, so it can be quite a tough way of losing. That was a good blow there. I think that blow was first straight to the stomach and the winding, so that is a good blow, good reverse punch. Just seeing that in action replay again. Roundhouse going in there. I think it comes in now with a, I'm not too sure now whether or not that was an actual punch or the actual roundhouse hit that winded him, but whatever it was a good blow and certainly results in a good score and point for him. Both exchanging some good, powerful techniques now. This is what the sport is about. When people come to see knockdown karate, they come to see full power blasts going in from the fighters, not semi-contact stuff like we saw in just one of the fights earlier where the crowd started responding with a slow hand clap. guy in the green belt showing himself to be the more determined and aggressive of the two. He's being driven out of the fighting area again, so the referee will stop the match and bring them back to the centre. And that's the end of that particular competition. It looks like we're back into the heavier weight of this particular competition now. Well, certainly the guy on the left looks like a considerable heavier. In fact, he looks considerably heavier than his opponent. I think the white weight spreads are very wide, as there is, I believe, only three weight categories in which these fighters compete. So that does leave quite a weight spread, really. I mean, the guy on the left of the screen right now looks quite a lot heavier than his opponent, that's for sure. So it'll be interesting to see whether the old saying of the bigger they are, the harder they fall actually works out. I have my doubts about that. This is an international Kyokushinkai karate event which is taking place in Holland. It's quite a popular sport in Holland. As you probably know, that the most popular fighting sport in Holland right now is Thai boxing, which has quite a considerable amount of similarities to this particular sport. In actual fact, many of those fighters who take part in Thai boxing also take part in these Kyokushinkai knockdown competitions because of the great similarity between the two sports. One training style complements the other. I would have expected to see far more forward driving from this bigger guy now. Now he's starting to be effective. That's what I would have expected. He's got a considerable weight advantage, probably something in the region of about 50 pounds, just looking at it. So obviously his tactic ought to be to drive forward and just use that power. His opponent quite obviously can't stand up to it. You can see every blow is... taken. That was a good roundhouse. It was a sweeping roundhouse kick to the head. Didn't quite manage to make full contact, but certainly looked good. Well, that's the end of that competition. I don't think there's going to be too much doubt as to who will have won that. The guy on the left has certainly dominated all that we've seen, and the judges believe the same thing as well, so that's no surprise that the decision goes to him. And now we're going to see some demonstrations of breaking techniques here. And if we're lucky enough to get the camera around into the right angle, I believe what they're going to be breaking here are in fact baseball bats, and they're going to be breaking those baseball bats with their shins. That is, kicking through the baseball bat using the shin. Which is not a thing I recommend that you try at home. And that's two successful breaks. That's quite amazing. Anybody who's ever held a baseball bat, you'll know that it is really very strong, very tough wood. It makes you realize just what the human body is capable of doing when it's properly trained. I know there may be some dissenters who are saying, ah, but they're only breaking through the thinner end of the baseball bat. Well, all I'd say to you then is if you don't think that that's particularly hard, then just don't try it yourself. We're back onto the competition again. There's a nice sweeping takedown there. As I said earlier, this is a elimination, series of eliminations where the winning fighter will go through to the next round. You see the guy on the left here in the yellow belt in the center of the screen now. He is, he was fighting earlier on. You'll remember that we see him fighting earlier on. He won the competition, so he's moved on now. We're into the next round of the eliminations. They continue to eliminate through until they find the champion in each particular weight category. This is the reason why you do have to be really tough to take part in this and to successfully take part in this form of competition, because you pick up some quite nasty bruises and injuries on the way through. Now there was a very, very powerful front thrusting kick into the midsection. You see it coming up and driving through straight there, right underneath the ribs. That was a very, very effective kick. And he certainly knows it. I think he's turned about three different shades of green there. Not surprising either. That really did go home. I've seen guys have to retire out of the competition altogether after taking a kick like that. Right, well that is a complete knockout. That's what you see. That's what the sport is all about. That was a body blow knockout which finishes the competition in one. They don't bother to award points on that. It's not a judge's decision, it's a complete knockout. Excellent technique. That's what the sport's all about. If you get the timing just right with the power and technique, then that's what happens. Now here's the short guy on the left, and before he was throwing all those quite spectacular jumping spinning kicks to the head of his much taller opponent, he's now fighting against a guy who's still taller than him, but a lot shorter than the other guy, so it will be very interesting to see as to whether or not he actually manages to make contact with any of those very spectacular spinning kicks that he was throwing earlier on. Mind you, not forgetting also that both of these guys have won in the last round, so he's going to be up against a superior opponent. That is a very good front thrusting kick to the face there, really excellent technique. Driving through and knocking him down. Obviously not really concussing him too much because he's gone straight back up onto his feet in fine style. Now this has proven to be a good match, very good match. The referee just warning him there for holding. As I told you earlier, fighters aren't allowed to grab hold of their opponent's legs when they throw them out, which is a good idea because all it really does is just stops the flow of the competition. And there was an attempt at that spinning kick, which has become his hallmark. Now, I think that he just hammered his heel into the ground there when he landed and has hurt himself a bit, so that might be a bit of a setback for him, although it doesn't seem to be having much effect. That was a good reverse punch. knockdown. Didn't actually do any real damage, but just knocked his opponent off his feet. Attacking again with that front thrusting kick to the head is a very effective technique. Big looping roundhouse kick, and then an attempt at a spinning kick there, just landing on the back of his opponent. Not very effective though. This is a nice match. Both of these fighters are using good, powerful techniques and making hard attempts at putting them in. It'd be nice if the cameraman would try to keep up with the actual action. That's over to the judges now, so I've got an idea it may go in the favour of the guy who's walked off screen now, the one on the right, because of the strike that he made with that front thrusting kick, so we'll just wait and see. Yeah, that's it. I think it was very much down to that strike, because there wasn't an awful lot in it otherwise. But that was a very good match. That was very pleasing. These two guys are choosing to fight close in, using kicks to the legs, punches into the body. Unfortunate thing about fighting this close in this particular type of competition is that you don't see such powerful and such spectacular techniques, because obviously you need the distance in order to build up the speed and power in a kick or in a punch for that matter. Ah, there's a nice spinning kick there, very nice spinning kick. Once again though, very difficult kick to land. Using those jumping spinning kicks there, but that really is a kick where you need to have distance in order to execute it with any effectiveness. It's really not the type of kick that you want to throw if you're standing very close or that close to your opponent as he was. Oh no, that's a nice spinning kick there, but again, just the distance is wrong for him to be able to get the power. He's managing to get his leg up there, but you really need a little bit more distance from your opponent, you know, and to be moving into your opponent in order to get the power behind a kick like that. Again, the referee stop and the competition as the fighters stepping out of the fighting area. That was another wheel kick. That was a little bit more in distance, but again, just not quite managing to make a full contact with it, partly because of his opponent ducking his head, which is what any sensible person would do when they see that sort of thing coming at them. So we'll wait and see what the judge's decision is now. And it goes over to the guy on the left. That was a very fair decision. He threw more nice technique, even if there wasn't an awful lot of very, very effective technique overall. That was just a slip, not a knockdown at all. But I wasn't greatly impressed with the guy that was in the screen now on the right in his last leg of the competition, so it'll be interesting to see whether or not he steps up the aggression this time round. I don't really think that was a hard blow, and neither does the judge on that side either, as she waves the flags to show that it wasn't a particularly hard thing. I really think that was a little bit more play acting. The technique just glanced off his chin at the most. I've watched an awful lot of karate competition, and under some rules it's really disappointing to see that a heck of a lot of fighters play at so much when they get hit to the face, sometimes with just a very, very light blow in the hope of getting their opponent disqualified and winning on disqualification. It's nice to see in this particular form of competition that disqualifications for blows to the face are rare. That was a rather abortive attempt at a jumping back kick to his opponent, completely out of distance and also off balance. Plus, the guy with the red tape on his belt is doing most of the attacking, but his attacks, at times he seems to be pulling back, particularly with his kicks to the legs. When he's throwing in low kicks, he doesn't seem to be driving in the power there, you know. Certainly driving in those reverse punches to the body. That's the end of that round. So I think if the judges judge on overall firepower, then it's going to go to the guy on the right, because he certainly threw much more technique. That's it. I think he won that basically just on throwing more blows than his opponent, which is fair enough, I suppose. Now that was a good roundhouse kick. And we see it coming up in action replay there. Just up and looping around behind the left ear. Good technique, not enormously powerful, but effective nonetheless. About turning his back on his opponent there, which is a particularly dangerous thing to do. I'm surprised not to see the judge referee coming over and warning him about that. We're getting an action replay there on something. I didn't actually see any particularly powerful technique there. I guess that kick must have winded him then. Yes, obviously that is it. It was deemed a powerful knockout kick. It didn't look particularly powerful, but I guess sometimes you can just hit the guy in the right spot at the right moment, and there you have it. Moving on to the next leg of the competition here, we've got our big guy over on the left again, since he looks like about the biggest guy in the entire competition, still powering his way forward, although he seems to be against a much more aggressive opponent this time, who's attempting to hold his own, although it must be very hard when you're giving away that much weight, because once again it looks as if he's at least about 50 pounds lighter than his opponent. Hear those low kicks banging in with power. And once again, barring the unforeseen happening, I don't think there's going to be much surprise about who'll end up winning this particular competition. Nice attempt at a spinning kick there, but being just out of distance. The referee warning him there for grabbing onto his opponent's uniform whilst punching at the same time, which is not allowed. Aggressively powering his opponent out of the fighting area there. It's all but impossible to stand up against a guy who's so heavy in this way. If you actually managed to drive him back, it would be a real feat. Now that was a very good, powerful technique there that went in. As you see the reverse puncher now coming through. I think again there was a roundhouse kick that followed it through, but it was the reverse punch that did the damage there. That will be a knockout, straight knockout, yeah. So we're going to go in for a demonstration again here. This is a double Carter demonstration looks as if it's going to happen. Carter, as you'll probably recognise, is a set routine of techniques, all of which are basically fighting techniques, although sometimes made far more elaborate for the sake of style. You recognise things as grabs and blocks, pushes, and then of course punches and kicks would be all utilised in this kata form. What I'm doing now is just basically demonstrating some fighting techniques. Not the type of techniques that would be allowable, or many of them not allowable in the competition that we've been watching. You see them there striking for the groin, and so on. also quite an interesting interlude to the main competition. Oh, and there's a nice spinning kick there. Again, as I described before, is called by some the rolling sea kick, and it involves a form of a somersault and spinning the leg out in an attempt to poleax your opponent with it, with the heel. If it lands effectively, it is very, very devastating. Powerful techniques being thrown in by each guy. Unfortunately, that low kick there catching his opponent in the groin. There's a front kick to the face there, but not really connecting sufficiently to do any damage. Another rolling C kick attempt there. A good and spectacular technique, but if it didn't actually land, then it's not going to do an awful lot of effect on your opponent. But nevertheless, it's worth a try, because when they do hit, they are very effective. I think the guy in the green belt slightly hurt his foot there with the with that last low kick that he threw. It looked that he contacted with his toes and stepped back limping slightly. And he seems to have got over it very quickly. Of course, during the course of competition, the adrenaline is flowing so high that you don't tend to feel the pain of things like that so much. It's usually an hour or two afterwards, when you're relaxing, that you suddenly realise that you've got bruises where you never knew that you had places to bruise. This is quite a good match, as both guys are really giving a lot into it. That'll be interesting to see how the judges come down in this one. I think it was very close, could go to a draw. He's calling one of the fighters into the area while they get the decision. Yes, it looks like they're giving a draw, so we're going to have to go through another 2-minute round to decide the winner on this one. Powerful low kicking coming from the guy with the green belt on. That's nice to see. That's very effective over the course of a competition. You're going to slow your opponent down with techniques like that. pace is beginning to tell on these two guys now. Although they're still throwing quite a lot of technique, they're just not quite managing to get the power behind it and make the contact. Oh, now that was a good technique. He timed that perfectly. Just as his opponent threw the punch, he spun over with that rolling C kick again, just clipped him around the head. Not quite enough though to make the knockdown, so it doesn't really make any great effect on the overall outcome of the match. And trying the same technique there, but being quite out of distance that time. And that's the end of that round of the competition. It'll be interesting to see who gets the decision, if in fact they do manage to come up with a straight decision on this one. I fancy the guy on the left, but we'll have to wait and see. No, again, this is going to a draw, so I think it will probably go on to the scales. And the heavier guy will be the loser. So the heavier guy was the man on the right, so the guy who I thought had possibly won it anyway, in fact, did get the decision, so that's quite okay in my book anyway. As I say, it can be a particularly nasty way of losing a fight, if you find that you lose just as a result of being just a couple of pounds or a kilo or heavier than the guy opposite you. That was a good wheeling technique, good wheel kick. Spinning there and striking with the outside crescent of the foot. Not quite managing to make sufficient contact. His opponent just turned his head in time there to be able to allow it to slip past his face. Referee warning both of them. That was a powerful roundhouse kick to the midsection. Attempted jumping spinning kick there, but being far too close for that. I sometimes wonder really why fighters, particularly experienced fighters like these guys are they bother trying techniques like that. That was a knee technique straight into the jaw. I think that's going to be deemed as a perfect knockdown. He was holding him at the arm on the right with his right hand, so there's a possibility that they could disqualify that move as being wrong because of holding on, but we'll just have to wait and see. It was definite that if they allow that technique, that will be a complete knockout, because he's obviously, I think, not capable of continuing. Seen earlier from the warnings that the referee has been giving to fighters who've held at the same time as using the knee, you're not allowed to actually grab on with your hand whilst using the knee. In this case, I don't think it's going to be deemed as a foul technique. I think it's going to be deemed a knockout. Yes. that is a straight knockout win for the guy on the right. That was a nice technique, really was. So I don't think that the holding of his wrist made any real difference to the technique. If he hadn't have had hold of him, it still would have struck home anyway. That was a third decision in my book. I think we just have the change around of the officials now. Now we have our big guy back on the mat again. But this time it looks as if the man he's in against is more of a similar weight, so let's just see just how this one turns out. Certainly a case of raw power where he's concerned. He's looks to me as if he's going in at probably around about the 120 kilos. He's certainly a hefty build on him. Having said that, his opponent this time has got to be up close to the 100 kilo weight, so not such a large difference in weight that he had with his other opponents. Nevertheless, he's still succeeding in overpowering the man in front of him. Yeah, the guy in the yellow belt is clearly intimidated by his opponent, constantly backing off. It doesn't really look to me as if he wants to get into any serious punch-up with him, basically. Just getting an action replay there of that last combination. Flicking kick up to the guy's face, but didn't really have very much effect. That was a good powerful reverse punch to the body of the yellow belt there. I don't think he's going to last this one out. He's certainly intimidated by his opponent, and he's looking quite exhausted as well. A good low kick there, stumbling him down, switching up to roundhouse to the head, but not quite managing it. Blasting him out of the fighting area now. You say if this does go the distance, it looks like it will now. If it does go to the distance, there's not going to be much difficulty in picking the winner, that's it. Just a little bit of action replay again of that roundhouse kick that he attempted. He's not a particularly flexible guy, this big fella, but he tried to go finish it off with a stylish one there, but just not quite managing it. Nevertheless, there'll be very little doubt as to the outcome of this particular competition. That's for sure. Okay, well, that's the end of this Kyokushinkai International Karate event. I hope you've enjoyed it. We're moving on now into the presentation phase of the competition. All of the competitors will be lining up very shortly on the mat to receive their trophies. So leave a little more for me to say. This is Phil Mayo signing off. Thank you very much, and I hope to be with you again soon.
Voor het sportschool uit Arnhem samen met de Tatami.